सो एज आई वाज सेइंग, हाँ, सो ऑक्सीडेशन विद KMnO4, वन ऑफ द रीजन व्हाई पीपल लाइक व्हाई इट्स काइंड ऑफ एन इम्पोर्टेंट रिएक्शन, व्हाई वी वांट टू स्टडी इट इज इट हेल्प्स इन फिगरिंग आउट द पोजिशन ऑफ द डबल बॉन्ड. Yeah, so if you have an alkene, like you did the test for unsaturation, and then like the bromine water, it became clear. Now you want to figure out ki which alkene is it, like how many double bonds are there, where is the double bond. If you want to figure all of that out, wo analysis karne ke liye, oxidize it with KMnO4, and once you figure out what products you got. So if you got a propane and ethanoic acid, it's kind of easy to figure out, like, you know, just wherever the double bond is there, wherever double bond oxygen is there, join them, and then there was the double bond. So kind of like, you know, this reaction will help you figure out the position of the double bond in the alkene. Yeah. So use of the reaction. This is not the only way you can do it. There's another way that you can figure out where the position of the double bond is. And that's also another way of oxidation reaction. And that is ozonolysis. Yeah. So this is another major important reaction. I think, do you have the mechanism for this? You don't have like the exact mechanism for it, but you do have like an intermediate product that's formed and all of that stuff. But this is also like extremely, extremely easy, just like KMnO4. Like once you get the hang of it, get like one simple logic and then you can easily figure out kya ho raha hai. Okay. So ozonolysis, from the name itself, you can figure it out. So you use ozone. Ozonol, matlab naam mein hai. You use ozone, O3. Lysis means breakdown. So you're literally breaking down the molecule using ozone. Again, pure ozone ke saath reaction is difficult. So you also use zinc plus water in the reaction. So this reaction, so pehle ozone is O3, right? So you add a molecule of ozone to the alkene. So while you're adding this molecule of ozone, your double bond is gonna break and it forms like a really complicated, like it's a house kind of a structure, looks like a house. And because that's like a lot of steric hindrance and all, like that house breaks apart to give your final oxidation products. Okay. So now because you're breaking it exactly at the point where the double bond is, this reaction is also used, or, you know, useful in doing this part. So ozonolysis is also used in figuring out where the double bond is in that particular alkene. Okay. Now because this reaction is going to be slightly bigger, I'll write the reaction in the next slide, next page. So once you're done noting down till here, I'll write it in the next page. Okay.
So what exactly happens in ozonolysis?
I will write it, like I'll put the reaction. So you're breaking the molecule at the double bond and you're adding oxygen at the same time. That's what happens in the reaction. So the kind of products you get are very similar to your KMnO4 oxidation. You still end up getting ketones, but you don't get acids in this. I think it stops at ketones and aldehydes. We'll see the reaction if we know the products.
Okay. Oh, and the zinc and like H2O in the presence of, like while you're doing like the ozone reaction, right?
I didn't catch that, Ritu. What? Presence of H2O what?
No, like when you're adding, you add like the ozone to the alkene in the presence of like zinc and H2O, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you do this reaction, like there's 3-4 steps to the reaction, and you do this in the presence of zinc and water. So if you want, you can also put down the final products of this reaction. So final products are, you get aldehydes and ketones. Again, whether you get only aldehydes, whether you get only ketones, or if it's a mixture of both, that depends on which alkene you're taking, just like the previous thing. But these are the final products. Now, this won't go all the way because it's not exactly oxidation. You're just adding whatever oxygen is in ozone. It won't go all the way to acids. Stops at like, you'll directly get an aldehyde ketone type product. Okay. So here's the reaction. So let's take propene, slightly complicated, CH3, CH double bond, CH2. Make it react with ozone, O3. So the first product or first step is direct addition of ozone. So in order to figure out the structure, this order will be the same. The focus is only on the double bond. अभी ओजोनोलिसिस हो रहा है ना, सो दिस बॉन्ड इज गोइंग टू कंप्लीटली ब्रेक ऑफ, सो लीव सम गैप बिटवीन दैट. ओजोन के 3 मॉलिक्यूल्स है ना, द स्ट्रक्चर इज समथिंग लाइक दिस, वेयर दिस इज अगेन ट्रैवलिंग बिटवीन बोथ. सो द ओजोन ऑल्सो इज गोइंग टू ब्रेक एंड यू गेट अ हाउस काइंड ऑफ अ स्ट्रक्चर. So this double bond gets divided between these two oxygen molecules. From this carbon also split between these two, and ozone ka this thing, it remains like this. So iska naam hai, whatever alkene you take, so it is that alkene ozonide. So because we started off with propene, this is propene ozonide. Like oxide, nitride, sulfide. Now, because you're getting it from ozone, call it ozonide.
It's two separate words, right?
Two different words, yeah. Propene ozonide.
Ma'am, I had a very small doubt. But why do these ozone or whatever, why don't they attack the single bond? Or why only the double?
Electron-rich areas, more reactive site. These, again, the double bond is in, like the pi electron cloud is above and below that sp2 wala plane, right? That's more lucrative. So, like, all of the reaction takes place because of electrons. It's all like electrons ka natak. Whole of chemistry is basically you're studying where are the electrons going, whether it's organic, inorganic, acid base, whatever it may be. So wherever there's electrons or charged areas, those are like the more reactive sites. Like if you start studying from that point of view, a lot of chemistry kind of becomes logical and it starts making sense. So even when we write out the mechanism of Markovnikov kaise ho raha hai, anti-Markovnikov kaise ho raha hai, go back and look at the mechanisms, we are actually tracing where all the electrons are going. Yeah. Okay, now this is kind of complicated, right? So this is not going to stay as it is. Remember, we're also added zinc plus water in for this reaction. So that's going to cause this to break down into 2 different products. So you end up getting on one side CH3, C, ye jo CH hai, it remains as it is, except it forms a double bond with one of the oxygens. And the same thing happens on the other side. So the CH2 remains as it is, and there's a double bond oxygen. So if you compare the reactant to the final product, what is happening is it is breaking up at the double bond, and yahan pe ek double bond oxygen hai, or the other side of it is getting another double bond oxygen. Okay. So if at all you need to predict the final product of ozonolysis, that's all you need to remember. Break it down at the double bond and add oxygen there. So that's where you get both of your products. यहाँ पे एक ही कार्बन है, so you get methanol.
And ma'am, the hydrogen directly connected with C won't gain oxygen.
No, because there's no like nascent oxygen you're getting. It's just like rearranging this ozone ka thing. So you end up getting only aldehydes and ketones depending on what you have here. There's no oxidation of hydrogen there. Like this is not involved in the reaction at all. So only the carbon and double bond oxygen.
Ma'am, I also kind of got disconnected for a moment. What did you exactly say after Zn plus H2? Like what exactly happened in that part?
Oh, so this basically breaks this molecule and gives you your final product. So with one of the oxygen, it basically forms a double bond.
What happens to the third oxygen?
Maybe you'll get either zinc oxide or zinc hydroxide out of it. The reagent basically triggers it, takes off one of the oxygen. So we'll come across a similar reaction when we do alkynes also, I think. It will change slightly because instead of a double bond, you have a triple bond. But yeah, so alkenes, alkynes, you'll find a lot of similarities. But because you have an extra bond between these carbons, the product will slightly vary. But mechanism or the logic behind it is like 80% similarities you'll find. Should we do another equation then? Let's go with 2-butene only. CH3, CH double bond, CH3. So iska ozonolysis products kya hoga? So ozonolysis, either you may get it in words or you may be asked O3 in the presence of zinc plus water. So just give me the final products. I'll write it as A and B. Yeah, you don't have to give me the intermediate, just give me the final products. That's it. Intermediate also, just in case you're given like reactants, this is A, this is B, this is C. If you're asked to identify, just be aware of this. But otherwise, like, 70% of the cases, 80% of the cases, you'll be asked for final products only. Rishit, like, you have given the final answer, but just put some thought into it, no? Agar ek hi molecule mil raha hai, toh you can just put twice of that. You can write it properly. You don't have to like print it exactly whatever I mentioned. Ritu, yes, absolutely. You got it. Like put some, like apply some, you know, like don't be like a computer. Like logic de riya, don't just follow it and print the final product. Do some analysis. Smira got it. Awesome. So Ritu, Smira, and Rishit have solved it already. Arnav, Adit, Sanat. Adit, no. Sanat, no. You're kind of there, but write it on paper, no. See, you're getting two different products. Like wherever the double bond is there, the molecule is completely breaking into two pieces. And then you have oxygen being attached there. Adit, like you need to count, like take care of where the double bond is, okay? Sanat, yes. So there's a different way you can write it. That's what I meant. Like, don't be like a robot. Basically, if you look at the test tube after this reaction, what will you be left with? Arnav, don't just make up things like C2H5 to nahi hai. You have CH3 and then single H only. Extra hydrogen kidhar se aaya? In order to find the product, be like a computer. But once you figure out the final thing, apply your brain there. So you have CH3, CH, double bond. Yahan tak same hi rahega, but yahan pe oxygen aayega. And then see what you get on the other side. CH, CH3 will be the same, double bond O. So essentially, both of these are the same things. You can see there is a CH3 here, attached to a carbon, which has a double bond O and a single bond H. This is also the same thing. So your final product, you'll get ethanol only. Right? You'll get two molecules of it. So either you can write it as 2CH3CHO, because you know this is ethanol, you're getting two molecules of it. Or if you're giving me the name, just say ethanol. Or you can say two molecules of ethanol. So you don't have to write ethanol plus ethanol. Like basically both are ethanol only, right? If they're different, you need to specify, okay, what is number one, what is number two, agar same hai, so just mention ethanol. Okay. This time I'll give you guys a different thing. So this is the kind of question that you may be asked. A sample on ozonolysis was found to give two products A and B. Okay. So a sample on ozonolysis gave A and B, like I'll just give you the structures of A and B directly. Gave acetone. And ethanol. So identify the alkene sample used. So, abhi tak, I was giving you the alkene, you had to figure out the final product. Yahan pe, I gave you the final products of ozonolysis. So, you need to reverse engineer it. Reactant kya hai isme.
Acetone and?
Acetone and ethanol. I put it here. CH3, C double bond O CH3, and CH3CHO. No, Rishat, yeah. So, to describe the structure, you may need to use brackets. Kyunki thoda sa branching hai. So, do it properly on your paper. Like, figure out the final thing. Don't be in a hurry. Like, I want accuracy more than speed at this stage. Yeah. Yeah, send a picture if you're more comfortable with that. Yeah. So multiple ways you can give me the answer. Either you can attempt writing the condensed form in the Zoom chat, or you can send a picture on WhatsApp, or you can give the IUPAC name. You know, may say you can send the answer in any way. Ritu, yes, absolutely. That is acceptable, yeah. There you go. Rishad got it. Yes. Smira sent IUPAC name. Yes, Smira is correct. So Ritu, Rishad, Smira, and Sanat also got it. Absolutely right. So Adit and Arnav. Nice. You guys got the hang of it. Ozonolysis, front and back, you're able to figure out. Good. So the way you can work it out, reverse engineering, like align the double bonds, because that's where you have the double bond O ek hai. The other product is CHO, so C double bond O, H, other side you have CH3. So ozonolysis may, these double bond O's are getting added. So in order to get the final alkene, get rid of this, इनके बीच में डबल बॉन्ड होना चाहिए. योर फाइनल प्रोडक्ट विल बी सी डबल बॉन्ड सी. इस तरफ एसीटोन से यू हैव द टू अल्काइल ग्रुप्स एंड इथेनॉल से यू हैव अ एच एंड सीएच3. ओके, सो दिस इज योर फाइनल प्रोडक्ट. सो इफ यू वर टू राइट द कंडेंस्ड फॉर्मूला ऑफ दिस, again, go along the chain. So you have CH3, C, C, CH3. Like if this is my long chain, start off with CH3. Phir yahan pe aaya C. This is a branch external to the chain. So this will be in brackets. Phir next step, yahan pe jaane ke liye, there's a double bond here. So add a double bond here. Then you have CH. Then next, go to the next carbon, CH3. CH3, CH, and CH3. Okay, so if you were to do a condensed, like yahan tak structures tak everybody's gotten it absolutely right. But if you were to write the condensed form, like this is how you would go about it. Go along the chain. Wherever you're going off chain, that will be in brackets. Like CH3 is a branch, that will be in brackets. Okay. Rishad, are you there? Like, have you Did you get this?
Get what?
I was just telling how to write the condensed form of the structure.
Yeah, yeah, I got it.
Huh. Okay. Adit, Arnav, where were you guys stuck? Kya hua tha? I didn't receive.
Got the diagram. I didn't know where to write.
Yes, I also got the diagram, but I don't know how to write the condensed form.
But that's so fine. I gave you guys options, no? IUPAC, like Sanath and Ritu had sent the image. Was it Ritu? Harishat had sent WhatsApp pe image. Photo nikal ke. Arnav, you were doing that past two questions ke liye. Could have continued that.
Yes, I like, but I had to try the condensed things. No?
Okay. Anyway, this is ozonolysis. And one final reaction of alkenes, but that's like, you have polymerization. Okay. What is polymerization? Do you guys know? Like, you've heard the word before, or can you connect it to something?
Is it related to polymers, like the plastic bags, polymethane, like we use now?
Like in polymers?
Yes. Okay. Correct, polymers basically are plastics, but do you know what polymers are like chemically? Have you studied that before?
Long chains. They're like chains of alkenes, right?
Not specifically alkenes, but Smira said long chains. So the long chains can be
I think it was also for alkene, right? I think you've done polymerization.
Yeah.
Not for alkene, but before.
Did we? Okay. Aromatization we've done, like production of benzene. Polymerization, yeah. Essentially, it's basically long chains. That's why you have very many different types of plastics, right? So depending on long chains of what, you get different plastics. Yeah. So the single unit that you start off with, so each unit of the polymer is called a monomer. Again, mono, di, tri, like a single unit, single agya, so monomer. So if you take so many of these monomers together, connect them all into long chains, either straight chains or branch chains, you get a polymer. Like monomial polynomial, monomer polymer. Okay. So from alkenes, suppose I'm using ethene. Okay. Can I write the reaction here or should I put it in the next page?
Next page. There's no space here, I think.
Yeah.
Or is...
Next page.
Okay.
I'm just a minute.
Huh. So you have like different plastics, like PVC is polyvinyl chloride. So if you take a vinyl chloride and then make a long chain out of it, you get polyvinyl chloride. So polyethene is literally polyethene. So you take ethene, make a polymer out of it, you get polyethene. So that way you can make polymers out of like a lot of different things, and each of them will have different properties. So you get different types of plastics.
So here, like ethene would be the monomer.
Yes.
And if we have a chain of it, then it will become a polymer, right?
Yes. So that polymer is polyethene, polyethylene bags. Yeah. Okay. So ethene is one example. So you have CH2 double bond CH2. Now, because you don't have like a set number of it, take N, like a lot of them, N number of them. So you heat it at conditions or, yeah, you take high temperature and pressure in the presence of a catalyst. So the double bond breaks and then all of them get connected to each other. So basically you have CH2, CH2. So instead of it being a single unit of CH2 double bond CH2, these electrons basically link multiple CH2s together. So you represent polymers this way. Like you put the bond across the brackets to show that it's a chain continuing this way. And this whole unit is repeated n times.
So what have we written after high temperature?
Pressure. So ethene se chalu kiya, you get polyethene. Similarly, if I take propene, so n molecules of propene, same conditions, high temperature and pressure, the presence of a catalyst. Then what do you think the product will be?
Ma'am, for the first one, I had a doubt. So what exactly happens after the high temperature and all? I didn't get that.
So this double bond, hai na, like there are two bonds, right? So the pi electrons, like the second bond, that gets broken and then you form like, it forms multiple bonds. Okay, I'll show you. So you have CH2, double bond CH2. Let's say you have another molecule. So yahan pe do electrons shared hai na. So these two, like there's a bond form between these two, like this becomes a single bond over here. And same thing happens on the other side also adjacent. Yahan pe ek aur bond form ho jayega. So that's how it forms like one long chain. So now, like based on like this also will remain. Adit guessed polypene. The name will remain polypropene, but where do you think? Okay, Ritu has guessed CH2. How is that difference from polyethene? But again, think of the
electron. Will it be CH3?
Kinda, close, yes. So wherever the double bond is there, only that turns into a single bond and that links all of the molecules together. So you have CH and then double bond CH2, right? So that becomes a single bond. And this is where all the linkages happen. And the CH3 that's connected to this one remains undisturbed. So this is the molecule, polypropene. So at least in the case of alkene,
why did the CH3 go down?
It didn't go down anywhere. Only in the representation it went down because I wanted another bond here. Like this doesn't exist in the chain. It exists apart from the chain because the chain is made of the atoms that were originally double bonded.
Oh, okay.
So two bonds out of which only one bond. So in the case of alkenes, during polymerization, what happens is double bond made, the second bond that is there, that is the one that links all of the molecules together. So double bond agar like yahan pe ek hona tha, but these electrons have gone and bonded with the other molecules forming this long chain. That's the only funda you need. Names, naming convention and all, it's pretty easy. Like ethene se aaya polyethene, propene se aaya polypropene. So if you come across any plastic with poly something, you can guess the monomer directly. Like poly ke baad jo bhi hai, that's the monomer. But if it has a completely different name like Teflon or something, then it's hard to guess. And yeah, those are the different reactions of alkenes. We're done with that. So we'll start with alkynes. Alkynes is going to be so much more simpler because a lot of their reactions are going to be similar to what you already studied in alkenes. So it's kind of going to be like a revision of alkenes only. The only extra with alkynes is the acidic nature. So alkynes are really, like, they show acidic properties because of the sp hybridization. That's the only extra thing. Others are all dictate what all reactions you have. Equation, okay. Acidic strength, addition reactions you have already done, and polymerization also you have it. That's it. Yeah, it is quite simple. So how are you guys feeling? Are you feeling fresh still, or so should we continue, or do you want to take like a 5-minute break before we start alkynes?
Let's take a break.
Okay. Cool. Abhi four exact four hua na, so we'll meet back at 4:05. Okay, so alkynes, as always, what has been the pattern with everything? The first one that we talk about is the structure. So what is the characteristic of alkynes? What defines them?
Triple bonds only.
Triple bonds, yes. And what is the hybridization of carbon for a triple bond?
For alkynes, it's sp.
Sp. So the hybridization is sp. So agar sp hybrid hai, to at this point, what is the bond angle or what is the geometry?
Oh, it will be linear or straight.
Yes, it's a linear molecule. Okay. In bond line format, whenever you come across a triple bond, it is literally just, it's a straight line. Okay, so for example, if you have ethyne, C triple bond CHH, no? So it is represented this way. Okay. And if you were to be, there's like a slightly longer chain, it's literally like this. This way. So basically, yahan pe ek carbon hai. On either side of the triple bond, there's like two more carbons, and then you have like carbons at the vertices. Yeah. So bond line format, mein, it's like, it, because it's linear, it's literally straight line with like triple bonds here. That's one thing. Okay. What else do we discuss? Nomenclature. How do you identify, or what is the name given to alkynes, like?
It was YNA in the end.
YNA.
So there's always ends with YNA. And if at all there's other functional group, the presence of YN represents that there's a triple bond. So if you have like a triple bond and an alcohol somewhere, then it basically ends with something like... like, let's say it's this sort of a compound. So then you basically have like number of carbon atoms and then position of the triple bond, YN, and then position of the other functional group and suffix of that. So in this case, OL. So I'm
ma'am, I had a doubt. So if we know that in priority rule, double bond is given more priority, right? So if there was a double bond and a triple bond in a compound, how would you name it, like the IUPAC name?
So if there's only double bond, triple bond in a compound, again, lowest, and I can't remember the priority order, but I'd share the list with you guys, right? So I think it's a double bond that gets the higher priority. But again,
yeah, yeah, double bond is higher than triple, but how do you name it? Like, it will be alkaline or what? No, because like
3-ene-5-wine, something like that. So the ene represents double bond, and third position, like third carbon, has a double bond. Ine represents triple bond, so fifth carbon pay, there's a triple bond. So that's how you figure it out.
If it was a branch, then?
Then you choose a chain such that it contains like both of these, just like with functional groups. Like if it's somewhere in the middle, you choose the longest chain, which contain like the main components of this. Okay, ion represents nomenclature, and then even if it is in tandem with other things, then like that particular YN part of it gets its own position number. Okay. Next, what else we talk about? Isomerism. What sort of isomerism will you find?
Chain.
Okay, structural may, yes, chain isomerism. Functional group isomerism, nahin. Position isomerism you'll find.
Positional?
Yes. Main isomerism, yeah, chain and position may, there's a difference. These are the structure wise. Do you think, just like we in alkenes, we found there was cis-trans-ka geometrical isomerism. Will you come across that in alkynes? There's no geometrical isomerism unless there's like an optical center, which we don't have to worry about now. Okay. These are the basics. There's nothing else to be that we can talk about alkynes. Structure of the triple bond, yes, it's linear. And then on the other two perpendicular planes, you have the p orbitals bonding. So, agar x-axis pe hai, so in the y direction, you have like one, and in the z direction, you have the other one. What else can we talk about this? Oh, bond, now again, like, because again, if it's a comparison between single, double, and triple, the bond enthalpy of triple bond is greater than the bond enthalpy in double bond, which is greater than the bond enthalpy in single bond. So this is the order of the bond enthalpies. Okay. And purely because you're having to break three different bonds in this case, compared to just two bonds in this case, compared to just one bond in this case. Okay. So these are like just basic introductory elements. So now let's talk about preparation methods of alkynes.
Ma'am, so basically, yeah, the energy required to break one bond of the triple bond would be the highest, right?
Yeah, one bond nahi. Matlab, if there is a triple bond between these two carbon atoms, the energy required to break these two carbon atoms apart will be the highest compared to the bond between these two versus the bond between these two. Okay. Right. Arnav, Ritu, yeah, once you guys finish noting this down, we'll start with the preparation methods. Okay. Preparation, we just have two methods of preparation methods here, methods of preparation. So the first method is from calcium carbide. Okay. We are studying this method because this is more, this is the industrial method of preparation. So if you have to get ethane on an industrial scale, this is how you, like, this is what is used right now in the world. Okay. Instead of saying industrial scale, say this is industrial preparation. So calcium carbide is not something that is readily available. So how do you prepare calcium carbide? So calcium carbide ka formula is CaC2. Remember, we talked about carbides when we were in the preparation of methane also. Like oxide is O2 minus. So whenever you have metal plus a non-metal and nothing else, like no oxygen, it's not a polyatomic ion. Basically ends with ide. Like that's why you have nitride, oxide, sulfide. That way metal plus carbon ka compound, you just call it carbide. Okay, so calcium carbide is CaC2. Pretty straightforward. Where do you get CaC2 from? Is the raw material used for this is limestone. So you take limestone, calcium carbonate. This is available in nature, like any marble stone, like white color stone you pick up, that's basically limestone. On heating this, you get calcium oxide, quick lime plus CO2. This is a pretty common reaction, like construction may hota hai. Like if you want calcium oxide or calcium related, like source is usually limestone. Carbon dioxide escapes out. Then heat the quick lime that you get with coke. Pure carbon. So this will give you calcium carbide CaC2 plus carbon monoxide.
So first to prepare ethane, we have to prepare calcium carbide first.
Yes. Because you don't get calcium carbide directly from an ore or from something. So limestone is the one that you can pick up from the earth. So you convert limestone into calcium carbide first, and then you process this calcium carbide. So calcium carbide on hydrolysis. Hydrolysis is nothing but make it react with water. You get calcium hydroxide plus ethane. So this is our required product. So ethane is the IUPAC name because alkyne here should end with ine. Iska common name is acetylene. Okay. So this can be a little confusing because common name ends with ene. But yeah, ethylene is ethene. Acetylene is ethane. Those are the common names. This is like the set of reactions used for preparation of system. So common names, like you have, this is quick lime. Calcium carbonate, limestone. These are like, this is what you would be used in industry. So quick lime, carbon in the form of coke. So coke is a form of carbon that is used in industry, be it extraction of metals, like extract purification of iron or copper. You heat it with carbon, like that particular type of carbon is called coke. So you get calcium carbide. This is calcium carbide. So on hydrolysis, you get lime water. Not lemon juice, this is lime water and acetylene. Okay, so once you're done with this method of preparation, the next one, I'll take it on the next page to be clear.
Ma'am, after alkynes, we still have to do a benzene, right?
Yes.
Is that like lengthy?
It'll take a whole class. It's kind of lengthy. It's like alkene. Again, it feels lengthy only because it's a new topic. Because we'll talk about resonance and Kekulé structure and all of that details, apart from your preparation properties and also. One person is missing. What happened to Arnav?
You are disconnected.
Yeah, saw that.
Wi-Fi is having some issues with that.
Okay. Rishit and Adit, you guys done? Okay. Rishit, your video is off, so I can't see. Okay. All right. Second method of preparation is from vicinal dihalides. Okay, so if it is normal alkyl halides, you get alkenes. But if you take dihalide, remove two of those HCl, HBr, whatever, you end up with alkyne. So essentially, the logic behind is the same. You're just doing the same thing twice. Okay, so you can refer back to preparation of alkenes from alkyl halides, the same thing, just that we're repeating it twice. So for example, if I have got CHHBr, vicinal matlab, it needs to be side by side. Treat it with alcoholic aqueous, alcoholic KOH. So aqueous hai to substitution ho jayega. So you need alcoholic to trigger the elimination reaction. So first step mein, one bromine plus one hydrogen gets eliminated. So we end up getting H double bond H and Br. And then if you let this reaction continue, like if the kind of quantities you take of the reactants and the reagent, you take it in the right quantities, it will trigger one more elimination where this bromine and this hydrogen get eliminated. So pehle isme minus HBr, then again minus HBr, you end up getting C triple bond CH and H. Okay, byproducts like KBr, H2O, whatever. You're eliminating an H and a Br essentially. Again, alternate reagents that you can use instead of alcoholic KOH, slightly stronger reagents. You can use sodium amide, Na plus, NH2 minus. Yeah.
Ma'am, is there any way like we can use normal alkyl halides and then get directly instead of doing it twice?
See, when you're when you're doing elimination, if I remove this bromine and this hydrogen, these electrons are basically forming your double bond, right? But if you want to prepare alkynes, you need a triple bond. So you need to trigger two different eliminations. Like if I use a normal, this thing. So let's say I have a Br here, I have an H here, and it's like a regular alkyl halide. So after elimination, I'm going to get ethene. Now, this is all completely, it's a proper hydrocarbon, right? So if you go back and look at the mechanism, there is a slight like electronegativity difference between carbon and bromine. So this being electronegative, it's going to keep pulling on this electrons, and it's easier to break these bonds here, which is absent in CH. It's not easy. Like you need something to trigger it to eliminate. Like it's difficult to eliminate H H2. It's more difficult to eliminate H2 than eliminating something more electronegative like a halide ion, which is why you take dihalides, because then you still have this halogen, and using slightly stronger reagents like sodium amide, you can like get rid of this bromine and subsequently one of the hydrogens to get your ethyne. So if your aim is to get an ethyne, you absolutely want two eliminations, like if you're going this route. So you take your substrate, which will make it easy for you to eliminate, like cause that elimination. And halides are relatively good leaving groups, which is why you don't use alcohols or diols also. Like compared to an OH group, halides are better leaving groups. So most of the preparation methods will involve alkyl halides or dihalides, things like that. Rishit, you said since it is dihalide, shouldn't there be two halogens in the product? Why? I mean, we're taking alcoholic KOH, no? So this will act on one of the hydrogens apart from the halogens. It won't act on both the halogens. If I used a different reagent, like this is what we used in preparation of alkenes. If I took metallic zinc instead of alcoholic KOH, I won't get an alkyne. This will get converted into ZnBr2 and I'll end up getting an alkene directly. But because I want to remove each one along with the hydrogen, I used alcoholic KOH and sodium amide, so that I can trigger a double elimination. So whenever we're doing alkynes, I want you guys to compare each of these sorts of reactions with what we did or what you came across in the case of alkenes. Like compare it, one, your mechanism, like because they're two different cases, it kind of gets clearer. And also doing a comparative study, it'll also help you differentiate, okay, alkenes ke case mein aisa ho raha hai, alkynes mein aise ho raha hai. It'll be easier to remember also. So this is just one preparation method. When we do properties, I told you, right? Except for acidic nature, all the addition reactions, we did addition in alkenes, we're doing additions in alkynes. Same rules, same this thing. So if you compare it, it's going to be really interesting. So. So these are the only two preparation methods we have for alkenes, you guys. One is industrial method from calcium carbide. And if you want to prepare it in laboratory, you can just do it using elimination reaction from vicinal dihalides. Okay. So after this, we've always studied physical properties. Nothing new or special here again. Physical properties of ethyne is going to be the same thing. Like it's a colorless, odorless gas. Okay, not completely odorless, just like ethene. Ethyne also has like a sort of a characteristic odor, has some sort of smell. Other properties are all like exactly the same as what you came across in alkanes and alkenes. So we'll take it up each one by one. Physical state. It's going to be a repetition of alkanes and alkenes. So the smaller members like C1 to C4 or C3, I think, tend to be gases. Then C4, say around C11, 12, tuck, you have liquids. And higher, like greater than C12 and above, you have solids. So appearance, they are colorless, odorless. So all members are odorless except for ethyne. I don't know the smell. Like, I haven't smelled it. Like, there's no description also. Just a characteristic odor. What else? We talk about solubility and density. So, density. Density increases with the number of carbon atoms, like within ethynes. But compared to water, just like alkanes and alkenes, they are lighter than water. What else we talk about? Solubility. So this also you can predict easily. What are they soluble in? What are they not soluble in? You guys fill it up in the blanks.
Soluble in non-polar
solvents.
Yes. Do you remember any examples of non-polar solvents?
Benzene.
Benzene, yes. What else? Benzene is one. Ether is one. Carbon tetrachloride, CCl4, is also another non-polar solvent. Just have like 3-4 in your mind. Because these are like the common solvents you'll be using like for doing reaction. Like acid base, how we do it in water, we take water as the common thing, right? That way organic, you use these solvents to do the reaction. Insoluble in polar solvents like water.
Ma'am, are there any other polar solvents?
There are lots. Carbon disulfide is one. Pyridine is basic, but it's an organic basic substance. So that's another one that's used. Toluene is one. Basically, you need to think of organic substances that are also liquids at room temperature. They will be non-polar solvents. And in order to be a solvent or like at least a medium where reactions don't take place, it needs to be inert enough that it itself doesn't get involved in the reaction, doesn't interfere with the reaction. So that way benzene and ether especially is like very, very good with that. If you start taking alcohols and amines and things like that, they like that OH, the lone pair of electrons, like they start interfering with the other reactants. So they, even though they are like organic solvents, they're not very good as solvents as such. Okay, so once we're done with this, we'll start talking about the chemical properties. Chemical properties, there are only two of them. We'll talk about the acidic nature and addition reaction. It's maybe polymerization here, but it's fine. question. Ritu, Adit. Adit, yes. So boiling melting points, this is like a common rule, like higher the mass, higher is going to be the boiling point, melting point and all. Since we don't have any oxygen, nitrogen, unka involvement nahi hai, it's all completely hydrocarbons we're talking about. So it's going to be pretty straightforward. Like more is the mass, more is going to be the boiling melting point. The only time you need to like properly look at the structure or the anomalies come in when if the mass is comparable and isomers, like we've seen this in alkanes and alkenes, like if there is branching, then that's going to affect it slightly. But that's only when the mass is comparable, when the only difference is in the structure. But if there is a difference in the atomic mass, molecular mass, then it's a pretty straightforward thing.
Ma'am, I kind of forgot, but how do you, you know, test the solubility? Like, how do you know it's, you know, soluble in non-polar or it's soluble in polar? How do you test that?
Oh, it's a universal rule, straightforward rule in chemistry. So like dissolves like. Okay, so if it is a polar substance, it's going to dissolve in polar solvents. If it is not a polar substance, if it's a non-polar substance, it's going to dissolve in non-polar solvents. Okay, so ionic salts like acids, bases, all of them, they get divided into positive, negative ions. So they are all polar, so they dissolve in water. Alcohol, it has electronegative oxygen. So there's like a lot of polarity there. So that is capable of dissolving in water. Hydrocarbons, they're completely non-polar, like symmetrical structures, and C and H, pura dipole moment cancel ho gaya. So that's non-polar molecule. So it'll be soluble in non-polar solvents. Okay, so like dissolves like. Yeah, that's like a universal rule in chemistry. Okay. So Arnav, Rishit, and Sanad, are you noting down or are you done? All right, Rishit, once you're done, we'll go to the next part. Chemical properties. Okay. Now, before we get to chemical properties, so is states of matter completely done at your school or is it still ongoing?
Oh, we are doing it right now. Like it's a second class.
Okay.
In Potar, after states of matter, we have also done the S or P block, the 15 group, and now we have also almost completed thermodynamics.
Completed thermodynamics, okay.
I think we are just about to complete it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, you guys just started it, but states of matter, Potar, how did you find it? Easy, difficult? Were you able to follow things, or is it completely like Latin and Greek? Yes, Atham.
I didn't listen properly because, ma'am, because the boards were going on, so each time the ma'am were shifting and they were also rushing it, so I didn't understand it.
Okay. All right. And Rajan's like you said, it's a second class, right? Kahan tak pahunche? How much have they completed? Have you done the different intermolecular forces?
Yeah, I was just checking that only. We did like Dalton's law of pressure or something like that.
You've already reached Dalton's law.
We finished, like my class, we finished Arden's law. We're like on ideal gas and like boiled point of stuff.
Start with the kinetic something, kinetic MO or something like that.
Kinetic theory. Oh my god, they're just and
we just started yesterday.
Oh wow, that's fast. Okay. Cool. chemical properties. Okay, as I said, only two chemical properties. We look at acidic nature and addition reactions. The first thing is acidic nature. So we're saying like alkynes are non-polar hydrocarbons. Like, where is this acidic nature coming from? Okay. So there are two reactions. That act as kind of a proof that alkynes are acidic in nature. Okay, so what do you know of acids? Like, if you had to detect an acid, one is, you use litmus and all that. But chemically, like, what kind of reactions do you know acids undergo?
Neutralization.
So basically, they react with bases, right? And then neutralize it. Ethines also undergo, like, if not an outright neutralization reaction, something similar to it. So what ethines do is, you take acetylene, HC triple bond CH, make it react with sodium metal. So we know metals are kind of basic because they react with acids, displace hydrogen. So a very similar reaction takes place here. So you get HC triple bond C. This holds a negative charge, attracting a positive sodium cation plus H2. So basically, if you were to balance it, sodium is capable of displacing the hydrogen in alkynes, just like it does with acids. Okay, and if you were to let it continue, it displaces this other hydrogen also. So HC triple bond C minus Na plus, give it more sodium, you end up getting something like this. It's two negative charges and sodium over here, sodium on over here, and displaces the hydrogen from here also. Again, if you had to balance it, here we go. So this kind of compounds, where it's an ionic compound formed with sodium, or the anions formed from removing H minus from ethyne, so these are called ethynides. Again, same pattern: oxide, nitride, whatever, sulfide. Ethyne se aaya anion, so ethynides. NaCl is sodium chloride. Yahan pe see, like, ethyne ka negative anion hai, so it's ethynide. Okay. So,
ma'am, I actually didn't get the point of this acidic nature. What does it actually do?
We're saying, like, ethynes undergo this sort of a reaction, which is similar to what happens in the case of acids. Like, you make a metal, like sodium, make it react with an acid like HCl or H2SO4, you get a salt, and sodium is capable of displacing the hydrogen, right? Here also the exact same phenomenon is happening, which means ethynes have some sort of an acidic nature. Now, these are not very strong acids, which is why they don't undergo that whole range of acidic reaction. Like, it's not like they react with iron, copper, zinc, any other metal. Like, you need a really, really strong electropositive metal like sodium to make this happen. But it's also like a proof that, like, you don't observe this with alkanes, you don't observe these with alkenes, which means ethynes have a greater acidic nature compared to other hydrocarbons. They display something of that sort, tendency to lose this H plus. Okay. And it's not exclusively ethyne. it is basically any, what do you call it? Any alkyne that has a hydrogen attached to this particular carbon. Like even propene shows it. C triple bond CH. So in order to observe this acidic nature, like acids need that free H plus, right? So you need to have a hydrogen bonded to this triple bonded carbon. These are all not acidic carbons. This hydrogen is the acidic hydrogen. And second, smaller is the alkyne, greater will be the acidic nature. Okay. Like the more alkyl groups, like hydrocarbon groups you add over here, further will the acidic nature change. And already in the case of propyne, you need a stronger base like sodium amide. For it to release this acidic hydrogen. So this gives you CH3C, triple bond C minus, Na plus, and ammonia. Here. Now, because this particular hydrogen is getting released as H plus, we can conclude that, oh, alkynes have like some sort of an acidic nature. Like the triple bonded carbon specifically shows that acidic nature. Like that is the carbon that's capable of releasing an H plus. So these hydrogens are not acidic. This particular hydrogen is acidic. Okay. So why do you think the reason, like what is so special about ethines that is not there in alkanes and alkenes? Like, why does ethene not show this kind of a property? Note it down, think about it, we'll discuss. So this is, since this is like new for you guys, this is sodium amide. NH2 is usually called amide, shortened it to sodamide.
Ma'am, can you go over this once more?
Just note these reactions. Like, take it as it is, Rishit. Like all of this doesn't have to fulfill a purpose. We're just observing what is the chemical nature of this. So we see that it reacts with sodium and like really strong bases like amides, displaces hydrogen. This is capable of releasing H plus. So that's why you have like Na plus, NH2 minus. Yahan pe this H plus combines with this NH2 minus to give ammonia. So we know that if something releases H plus, that's what we define as having an acidic nature. Right? Which means that from these reactions, we can see that, oh, alkynes are showing some sort of an acidic property. So where is that acidic property coming from? Like, why do we not see this with alkenes and alkanes? Why are we seeing it only with alkynes? So that's what we are going to reason out. So first comes observation. Then you look at kyu ho raha aisa. So this is the property, it undergoes these reactions. But why? So once you're all noted down, like just focus here, then we will discuss why. In the meantime, if you have ideas about this, you can definitely put forward.
The question was, why is ethane acidic? Is it?
Yeah. Like, why ethane specifically when not ethane or ethene? Because all of them are hydrocarbons. Ritu has attempted an answer here. Okay. Interesting. But that's not the reason. Like, they might as well not react with anything at all, right? It's not a compulsion that they have to lose something. Like, if you put sodium and ethane, like, nothing's gonna happen. Like, so the same can be the case with this also. Arnav, have you finished noting down?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Rishit, what about you? Okay. Why is your video off, Rishit? Like, it's been a while.
Some people are there in the background, so I've just kept it off.
Okay. All right. So, take a look at ethane. And then you have ethene. And we have ethine. Okay. So ethine is the one that has like acidic hydrogens, which is not present in ethane or ethene. Okay. These hydrogens are not acidic. Nothing happens here. What is the difference between... Look, if there's a difference in the properties, that difference has to come from somewhere, right? So let's look at what is intrinsically different between ethane, ethene, and ethine. What is the difference between all these things?
The hybridization.
Correct. So yahan pe, what is the hybridization of carbon?
SP3.
SP3. What is it here?
SP2. I got it. Why?
Or yahan pe, what is it?
SP.
SP.
So, Adit, what? So, what if then?
Like you said, now, like this, how electronegative hydrogen, like basically. So, what happens is, like, here it's 75% of it is not that. So, 25% is here. So, 50% of like SP is the most. So, if you do the math, and alkynes, you have the most acidic. You have, it's more acidic compared to alkanes and alkenes.
Absolutely. Exactly. That is exactly the reason, Nader. You got it. Yeah. So, because of the hybridization, like, you need to go back and remember what we learned in chemical bonding. Okay. So, sp3 hybrid orbitals have 25% of s character. SP2 has 1/3, like 33% S character, and SP is equal parts of S and P, so 50% S character. Okay. Now, if you remember, what is the difference between S orbitals and P orbitals, like the nature of S orbitals and P orbitals? S orbitals basically have like because of 50% S character, the electronegativity of sp is the greatest, followed by sp2, followed by sp3. See, why is electronegativity of sp greatest? It's because it has maximum s character, and it's the nature of s orbitals to hold those electrons tightly. Like that's where your screening effect, like spdf, s can screen maximum because, you know, can hold those electrons tightly. Penetration effect, all of these comes from the difference between s, p, d, and f orbitals. Okay, so all of this affects the overall electronegativity of sp hybrid orbitals. Now, what do you mean by electronegativity?
Ability to pull electrons towards itself.
Correct. Pull electrons, or if you already have electrons, hold those electrons with you. Right? So this is basically tendency to hold electrons. Okay, if it's already a bonded pair of electrons, like you want to hold on to them tighter, like you get them towards itself. So between these three, this particular carbon can hold this pair of electrons easily. So if it is taking hold of both of these electrons here, it can let go of hydrogen as H plus more easily. So because sp has maximum electronegativity, this implies, like, a consequence of this is that triple bond C, yahan pe kuch bhi ho sakta hai, but this particular carbon, it can, like, or let's say this. So it, these electrons can be held by this carbon. And so this conversion can happen more easily, which is absent in these two. Like, these are like, oh, I don't care about these electrons. If hydrogen takes both of them, it doesn't care. If it takes one of them, like, that's what's happening in homolytic fission, right? So in these two cases, anything can happen. It completely depends on the reagent. But in this case, because this particular carbon can hold on to these electrons tighter, it can lose H plus while still forming an anion, which is basically translating into acidic nature.
Ma'am, electronegativity can also be the tendency to pull electrons towards themselves, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Pull electrons, pull the bonded pair, or if they already have these electrons, hold on to that pair of electrons. So you can write it as hold, or like, even if you say pull, the logic remains constant. It pulls these pair of electrons towards itself. So let's go of H plus, and it itself holds these electrons.
So like, the acidic nature can also be described that it has the ability to give off H plus ions, right?
Yes. So the more easily it can give off the H plus, the more acidic we say it is. Okay. So now that we've established ki why do alkynes have acidic nature, we'll look at comparison. Which one forms a stronger acid? Within alkynes, what is the trend of acidic nature? We'll look at all of that. Okay.
Awesome, ma'am.
Yeah.
Could you just say, what did you exactly do in the last part? Like C triple bond, C a single bond H, that part, what did you do?
So these arrows means they show the movement of electrons. Again, I've been saying this, Rishit, right from the beginning. We've done this during mechanisms also. Whenever we use this sort of arrows, it basically shows movement of electrons. Abhi, it's starting from this bond, right? So both these electrons present in the single bond are moving to this carbon, which is why this carbon got a negative charge, ek extra electron mil gaya, and the hydrogen lost electron, so it's gone as H plus. Yeah, so basically, because sp, this is more electronegative, I said this movement is easy and feasible. So it can give away H plus easily. So that's acidic nature. Okay. So Sanat, Arnav, Rishit. Okay. You've noted down, theek hai, but yahan tak, is it clear why are alkynes acidic? So again, using similar logic, can you compare the acidic natures of alkyne? We established it is pretty acidic, but what is the acidic nature order of alkanes, alkenes, alkynes? So kya hai order?
Alkynes is greater than alkenes, then it's greater than alkenes.
There you go. Yes. So this is one aspect of it. Then the next aspect of it. So if I compare ethyne and propyne and butyne, and so on, like, what is the acidic nature, increasing or decreasing?
Decreasing.
Decreasing is absolutely.
I too think decreasing.
Okay, so acidic nature decreases, like ethyne is maximum acidic, followed by propyne, followed by butyne. But why?
You said na pehle ki smaller the alkyne, greater the acidic nature.
Huh, that logic I gave you guys.
So based on that.
Okay, but why?
Ma'am, I think because, see, there is, if the triple bond is there, only single triple bond, then it's the, they can hold electrons better. But once single bond starts coming in, the number, it decreases, right? The hold on the electrons.
But why? What is the connection between whatever is bonded here to this particular triple bond? Like, yahan pe, how are these atoms affecting this particular part of it? That is the only thing changing. Like, all of them are triple bond, CH is constant. The only thing changing is the part bonded to this particular, like beyond the triple bond. So what do you know about the nature of alkyl groups? Ritu got it. Yeah, kind of, but yeah, related to that effect for sure. Somebody else, like, what is like the inherent nature of alkyl groups? What did you learn about alkyl groups? What did it do in organic compounds? See, organic chemistry may, like, acidic nature, basic nature, these are not common, which is why we are studying them as special chemical properties. But what did you learn, like basics of organic chemistry mein, about the nature of different groups? Like, how do you categorize them? Like, you learned about electrophiles, nucleophiles, theek hai. But within an organic compound, if there is an OH attached, if there is COH attached, if you had an NH2, if you had alkyl group, like, what is the inherent nature of these kind of groups? Okay, I'll give you a hint. So are they electron withdrawing groups or are they electron donating groups? You guys remember electron donating, electron withdrawing?
Are they electron donating?
Okay. Smeha, Sanath, Rishit, Arnav, what about you guys? What
I think they're electron donating.
Ritu and Arnav also have said electron donating. Good, you guys kind of remember a little bit of it. Sanat, Rishit, what happened?
I don't remember.
Don't remember? Okay. So, alkyl group...
I didn't get your question. What was the question?
So, what is the nature of alkyl groups? I asked if they were electron withdrawing or electron donating. So alkyl groups are
electron. Yeah, I also forgot. I know what they are, but I don't not know for alkyl.
So electron donating groups. Yeah, that is why your tertiary carbocation is stable. Because carbocation lacks electrons, and the alkyl groups basically donates the electrons. So jisko nahi hai, you're like they're like giving some of their electrons there. So this makes it really stable. Okay. So alkyl groups are electron donating groups. Just remember that. Okay. So if they're electron donating groups, they have the tendency to push electron towards like whatever functional group is there. Now this triple bond already is pretty electronegative itself. It can hold on to these electrons, pull these electrons towards itself. Further, if the alkyl groups are pushing more electrons, it's like overload of negative charge here. Like this carbon does not like it. So makes it less and like that particular anion makes it less and less stable. And because of that, it will not lose the hydrogen as easily. So that's why as long as there's electron withdrawing groups or if it doesn't have any alkyl groups, you're going to have a better acidic nature. Okay, so you can like write it down as a rule. So suppose I have C triple bond C, H, and yaha pe, I can't write X, let's say A. So if A is electron withdrawing group, then acidic nature increases. And if A is electron donating group, then the acidic nature decreases. Okay, so A is basically the group attached beyond the triple bond. So ethyne is like maximum acidity compared to propyne, butyne and all. But instead of hydrogen, if I just put a fluorine here, this is going to be more acidic than ethyne. So generally, electron withdrawing groups increase your acidity. Electron donating groups decrease acidity. So you'll find this pattern even for phenols and like other organic compounds that have even a little bit of acidic nature. This is the trend. Electron withdrawing here, matlab, acidic nature increases, donating matlab it becomes less. Write it properly here. So as the number of carbon atoms increases, so your acidic nature decreases. Okay. So this is like as a general rule. On the other side of the triple bond, if you have an electron donating group, it decreases the acidic nature. That's why as the hydrocarbon increases, acidic decreases. But if you have electron withdrawing, it increases. So fluoroethane will be more acidic than pure ethane. Pure ethane is more acidic than propane and butane. And then we have addition reactions. This is more or less like a revision only. So just a quick revision of Markovnikov, we'll be using that. So we don't have to go through the mechanism and all once again. It's like quick reactions. Ritu, Adit, Arnav are done. So Smera, Sanat, Rishit, once you guys are done noting this, we'll go to the next one. So the second property we'll look at is the addition reactions.
Ma'am, could you wait for 5 minutes? I just need to get a refill. My refill just ran out, so I need to go and get it. So could you just wait for some time?
It's already like almost 5:15. Hurry up. I just wait. So addition mein what all we have? Addition, first one is your hydrogenation reaction. You remember what is hydrogenation?
Add H2 and then palladium, nickel.
That's it. Same thing. It's just the number of H2 will change because we are dealing with ethane here. So catalyst also you done either palladium or platinum or nickel. Product kya aayega?
Ethane.
So two hydrogen matlab you'll directly get ethane, but think of it two steps. So pehle you get ethene. Remember, we discussed this during production of ethene, like method of preparation. Then, if you don't really control it, same conditions, two steps, you get ethane. The next one, addition of halogens. So we'll change it up a bit. Oh yeah, like here we'll look at Markovnikov, anti-Markovnikov and all that. So let's say I have propane. And I'm adding bromine. What will be the product?
Is this like the previous one where you get like the blood up in two steps and we have to give you like the second one or like the extreme end?
Yeah, give me the intermediate. So it's good to know the intermediate also because then you're ready for both, essentially. Ritu, the last carbon in your structure, it only has three bonds. It's not fulfilled.
Oh.
Adit, yes, absolutely. But can you be a little more specific? Like,
oh, yeah, draw it and just the number.
Where will they be added?
Excuse me, ma'am, what's going on? I got disconnected.
Oh, so hydrogenation, hua. So we're looking at halogenation. So this is also a form of addition reaction. So first addition product, kya hoga? Ritu got it. You learned this during reactions of alkenes. So bromine, two atoms, hai na? So both of these basically get added on either side. Yes, now we got it. So CH3, C, Br, double bond, CH, Br. There you go, Rishit also got it. CH nahi hoga. Look at the valency, Rishit.
Yeah. I found it. Yeah.
So if you, again, let the reaction continue, have another molecule of bromine, you'll get like a monster of a product. Yeah. So it's exactly what you guys learned in alkenes, but because there's an extra bond, you have extra step for each one. These two are pretty simple. Hydrogen halide and water. Okay, these two are like slightly complicated. Water will take up last. Hydrogen halide is the simpler of these two. Hydrohalogenation. Again, so you have CH3, C triple bond CH plus HBr. So tell me, where will the bromine get added? Like, or where is the hydrogen? Where is the bromine? Like, if I call this 1, if I call this 2, so carbon atom 1 may what is added? Carbon atom 2 may what is added?
1 gets the hydrogen and 2 gets the bromine.
Awesome. Markovnikov rule. Right? Same thing. So the first addition will be CH3. CBr. Yahan pe single bond aayega ki double bond aayega?
Double bond.
There's only one HBr added till now. CH2. And then similarly, figure it out. Addition of another HBr. Same Markovnikov rule. CH3C.
Ma'am, is it hydrohalogenation?
Huh. Kyunki hydrogen added hai, halogenation. Halogen added also. Okay, this went like slightly to the corner, but when you have two bromines on the same carbon atom, so this sort of a dihalide is called a gem dihalide. So it's geminal dihalide. So in nomenclature and all, it's shortened to GEM. So you have, this is a Wick dihalide, vicinal dihalide. This is a GEM dihalide. Okay. So if it is adjacent, vicinity of each other is Wick. Same carbon atom, GEM. So the two Adit are done. Smera is also done. Cool. The fourth reaction, we look at addition of water. Now this will be slightly different from the other addition reaction we saw. So addition of water. Step one will be the same, okay? So we do ethine only, keep it simple. Plus H2O in the presence of H plus. So this addition, not particularly easy, happens at high temperature. First product, you guys can predict fairly easily. Kya hoga first product?
There will be a double bond, right?
Double bond, okay. Then?
Ma'am, what is the reason above Hg?
Hg2+. This is mercury ion. Huh.
And
will there be an H2?
One of them, yeah, H2, okay. Fifth?
OH will be for the next one.
Then yep. H.
H. So these H's will remain as it is. H2O say ek hydrogen or ek OH add ho gaya. Okay. Now, this is where it is different from other reactions. Okay. So just write this down and then I'll show what happens. Or wait, don't write it yet. Like, let's complete this part. Don't write it yet. So, oxygen has lone pair of electrons, no? Oxygen is electronegative. There's already like a pair of, like, there's extra pi electrons over here. So, there's a double bond and OH. So, this kind of compound is something called an enol. En is double bond, ol is alcohol. So, enols are usually, like, every time you come across an enol, that gets converted into a ketone or an aldehyde. Okay. So every time there is this sort of a configuration, hydrogen here. So what happens is this hydrogen, so basically, like essentially this pair of electron migrates to this particular thing and this hydrogen is captured by this particular carbon. So this gets converted automatically. There is isomerization here into CH3CHO. Okay. So a lot of times, like yahan pe, because there is CH2, you ended up getting an aldehyde. But usually when this happens in the middle of the chain, like suppose if I had taken protein, if I had something like this. Then, so like basically this sort of a conversion is called keto-enol tautomerization. So whenever there is a configuration of an enol, that automatically gets converted into a carbonyl group. So typically when it's in the middle of a chain, it becomes a ketone. So you end up getting like, it's a conversion between ketone and enol. So that's why it's called keto-enol tautomerization. Okay. But because of this, you don't get an opportunity for a second addition. Like you don't get diols from this. So after the first addition, this isomerization takes place. So enol gets converted into aldehyde. Aldehyde if it's at the end of the chain, ketone if it's in the middle of the chain. But because of this isomerization, you don't have two steps of addition reaction. So this is like a characteristic of ketones also that end up having a alpha hydrogen, like that has its own chemistry. That's its own study altogether. But yeah, so when both of these are in place, there's something called a keto-enol tautomerization that takes place. But yeah, so for the sake of this reaction, just know that whenever there's addition of water, you end up getting an enol. So enol ends up getting converted into a double bond, you get a carbonyl group. Okay. And depending on like yahan pe hydrogen hai, so you end up getting an aldehyde. But if this triple bond is in the middle of the chain, you end up getting ketone, depending on whatever it is.
Ma'am, so like if we have to write the product in a question, so like do we write the enol and then the aldehyde or ketone, or like directly the aldehyde?
It depends on the question. Like a lot of times your questions, you'll be given the reactants and then this will be indicated as A, B, C. Like if you see that isomerization ke pehle there is one product, baad mein there's another product, then you know that A is enol, B is this. So, and depending on if there's like a further react, like if there's a reaction further to it, which involves like reduction of aldehydes or oxidation of aldehydes or something like that, then you know that, okay, that particular thing, it's not an enol, it's actually this thing. So, context clues. And if it's an MCQ, well, like the options are right there. So whichever is the most, you can choose that. Yeah. And then finally, you have polymerization. Just like ethines, you have polyacetylene. And so like, okay, the main concept in polymerization is you have like two types of polymerizations. The third thing. So one type of polymerization, you have linear polymerization. So linear polymerization is like line mein jo hai, So you let's consider ethyne only. So N ethyne molecules, just like with ethene, one out of these three bonds breaks, and then you end up having this N times. Yeah. Now, because you're getting a line of these things, and so on, like it, because it's forming a straight chain in like that, that can be laid out as a line. This is called linear polymerization. And then the other kind of polymerization is cyclic polymerization. In this case, again, by contrast, this is forming a molecule that's like a straight chain. This will form a molecule that's in a ring structure. So three of these on polymerization, you end up getting benzene. And if you remember structure of benzene, that's again alternating single and double bonds. Here also that's the same thing happening, except it's in a straight line. Because it's a ring structure alternating single and double bonds, you end up getting benzene. This is polyacetylene. Because you started off with acetylene. That's it. So that leaves us with just benzene, like aromatic compounds. One more session and we should be